Yeah.
Hi, everybody. Mike Kelly here. I'm really excited to continue my series on grading practices. This is the fourth installment of my grading series vlog posts. And if you haven't had a chance to see the first three, I'd really love for you to take some time and go check those out on my YouTube channel. I have all three of them shared there, so you can go back and look at those. In those videos, I talk about the purpose of grading, what should be included in a grade, and some other things such as the total points method versus using weighted categories and things like that. So a lot of good practical discussion and sharing related to grading practices in a traditional grading setting. So please feel free to check those out. Also, please go subscribe if you'd like these videos and like to continue to follow my journey as I discuss and talk about a lot of different topics related to education and leadership. So today is series four of our grading series, and today I'm going to talk about marking periods. Now, this is something I have mentioned a little bit in some of my other talks and vlogs, and it's something I've written pretty extensively about. So if it's something you'd like to read more about and some of my thoughts on it, you could check out principalmkelly.com, which is my blog, and you can follow along with some of my blog posts related to the end of marking periods and eliminating marking periods, which I'll be talking to you about today. So to get right into it, to share, our middle school has eliminated marking periods. We have one year-long grading period. So that means students' grades are calculated cumulatively over the course of the entire school year. There's no stop. So one of the things that helped this be possible in the beginning was we eliminated paper report cards. So if you are somebody that still issues paper report cards, that's going to be an additional hurdle and certainly something to consider before you would move in this direction. So I'll put that right on the table. So the expectation sort of in our district about 5 years ago became that parents were now checking grades online, that report cards would be issued online, and you had to go online and access those things if you wanted to see them, that we didn't send paper report cards home. So now that parents were accessing grades online periodically as they saw fit, it really decreased the need to have these end times, these end of marking periods, to stop the calculation of a grade and reset it moving forward. In addition, some of the other things that had come up as we continue to improve and change our grading and assessment practices in our building, one of the things that teachers came back with was that, you know, we were doing a lot of reteaching and retesting, and our assessment sort of approach to assessment became more of a cycle that was ongoing, was that teachers were able to do this up into a certain point. Because once we got to the end of the marking period, if a teacher gave a test or assigned a quiz or an essay or a lab, that they felt that was more permanent, that they had to grade those things to get them in, and then the marking period ended and the grade was finalized. So those practices such as reteaching and retesting, and also just the assessment cycle was being stopped. So we identified that being as an obstacle to our grading practices. So one of the things we discussed was, why don't we eliminate marking periods? What if it was a cumulative grade? And so we piloted this in our sixth grade, and it went really well. We learned a lot about the importance of communication with parents, certainly up front, communication with students, and the importance of being able to follow along with a cumulative grade. And there are some great learning experiences along with that, as simple as, wow, the grade book gets really long when you go online to look at all the different assignments when it's not sort of separated into quarters or marking periods. But at the same time, things went really well. We got a lot of good feedback from teachers. We extended that into seventh grade the following year, and then eighth grade the third year. So now it's implemented in our entire building. So we have year-long grading periods. So that means a student's grade is calculated cumulatively in all grades in our middle school, and it's going really well. It again has allowed these natural assessment practices to occur without any interruptions or artificial arbitrary timelines. So I'll talk more about that. So what marking periods do is create some issues in traditional gradings. First and foremost is sort of this equity and the mathematical piece. So we all know not all marking periods are created equally. And what I mean by that is the amount of content we cover in one marking period compared to the others differs. And that may be because in the beginning of school, we have a lot of exciting events that may take up some time and we cover less content, less number of units, those type of things, less assessments. The end of the year, we run into the same thing. And certainly during the third quarter, traditionally, was our state testing, which takes up like 3 weeks of instruction. So what we found was, let's say, for example, we would cover 3 units the first marking period, 5 units the second marking period, 3 units the third, and 3 units the fourth, or whatever it may be, a breakdown, something like that. And however, when this grade was calculated at the end of the year, each marking period was given an equal weight. And really, mathematically, that's not appropriate, because if we covered, in some cases, twice as much content from the second marking period as compared to the first, those really mathematically shouldn't be given the same weight. And the truth is, if you're following a natural assessment cycle and you're adjusting your pace for your students, it may differ year to year. So it's not necessarily as simple as even weighting each marking period a little differently up front, because that may differ from teacher to teacher. So mathematically, that became an issue because, again, if I'm covering 5 units in one marking period and 3 in another, and then at the end of the year, I'm giving those marking periods the same weight, that's not mathematically appropriate. It's not a good calculation of the grade at the end of the year. And not to mention, again, going back to sort of the problem with the assessment cycle being stopped, we create these arbitrary timelines for learning, which we sort of want to get away from. Again, I don't know that it's practical to have 30 or 150 kids if you see them in a day on 150 sort of paces throughout the year in their learning, but certainly there needs to be some flexibility that we can't just say, okay, you know, you didn't do well in this assessment, and since it's the end of the quarter, we have to stop and you can't go back and learn that. Well, if we feel that learning is important, why not? Why are we creating and letting these sort of arbitrary timelines that we put in place to really affect instruction or interfere with the grade calculation being accurate and interfere with our assessment cycle? So those are some of the reasons why we moved forward and made those changes. And again, it's been really successful for us. And it's something, you know, we continue to tweak and evolve with regard to our assessment practices. But it certainly has removed a barrier and an obstacle that had been there before. So I certainly recommend, as a way to sort of enhance your grading and assessment practices, to really take a critical look at what's the purpose of marking periods to begin with. Again, really, it was just to issue a periodic report to the parents. Well, now parents could check on their grades, their child's grades online anytime, 24/7 in real time. So why would we need to just arbitrarily send a report home when by the time sometimes the parents check it or it would be sent home in the past, the grade had already been updated and changed. It's almost no longer current. So again, those are some reasons why we moved away from that practice. This is something that we continue to discuss even as a district with some of our other schools. I know schools that have standards-based grading, a lot of times we'll use a year-long grading period, but you don't need to go full standards-based grading. If your school and district is not ready for that or doesn't agree with that philosophically, you can still look at the way you're currently doing marking periods and quarters and really consider whether that aligns with your grading, assessment, and instructional practices. The last piece I'll share that really came out of this was teachers gave a lot of good feedback that this allowed them to continue their instruction in a more natural way. So a lot of times teachers felt the pressure to either speed up their instruction to fit something in right before the end of the marking period or to slow it down because they didn't want to start something new the week before the end of the marking period. So sometimes instruction got rushed or it got slowed down artificially. So now this allows a more natural pacing and progression of planning your instruction and your lessons. So that was another benefit of doing this that we heard from our teachers. Those are just some of the things that we've learned in our experience eliminating marking periods. I hope you've enjoyed listening to this discussion. If so, certainly I encourage you to hit subscribe and subscribe to this vlog, as I'll be discussing not just grading, but many other aspects of education through this medium in the future. Thanks again for joining me. I really appreciate it. I hope you have a fantastic day.
Yeah. The Mike Kelly way. The Mike Kelly way. Whoa. Learning how to educate. We gon' get it straight. We could do it the Mike Kelly way. The Mike Kelly way. Listen to him predicate. You gon' be amazed. We could do it the Mike Kelly way. The Mike Kelly way. Whoa. Clean cut professional as what?